the budget workshop. We will go until 6:30, and PDF is joined up at the table.
That's a good one. Rich, do we have a new iPhone password?
We do, yes, it just changed.
Oh, that's it. Automatically connects.
All right, so this is a, this is our preliminary budget workshop discussion. Please bold and I'll be preliminary.
Okay.
Yeah, I was gonna leave that off before I... This is by no means close to your final number. We've still got, we've put a bunch of markers in here, and we know that we need to clean those up. So don't even, the final number is not a real number.
So there's three different reports in here. It's not your full packet like you normally get, because once we finalize, you'll get all of that. But this is basically one complete total budget, one for elementary, one for middle, one for high, at this point. All right. Just because there's gonna be so many changes between now and when you're really your first look at the actual budget, that will you get your whole complete packet like you always do once that.
And this is the first time we're seeing this, so we'll take a few minutes to take a quick look through it. And unless you'd like to just give us,
Just notes. So basically, just first off, things that aren't included in here that are left flat as our current thing. The SAU assessment is number one, because that budget hasn't been done yet. Marshwood tuition, they have until November 1st to give us a rate, so it's left flat at what we're currently paying. We're waiting on some...
He went to get the Wi-Fi password.
We're waiting for some figures from Rich, because we changed our process this year. We've asked for things to be broken out in more detail than before, so supplies, you may see five or six lines in here now for supplies. It could be math supplies, science supplies, health supplies, you know. So he's been meeting with the staff to really break those things out, so it's taking a little bit longer to get those figures, because it's different from what we've been doing in the past. So we're waiting on that. We're waiting for some estimates from maintenance items that Dick is wanting to put in here, but he's getting some estimates. And revenue. You're not gonna see any revenue sheets in here, because we have to wait till November for the state to give us our estimates for those too. So those are just a couple of things. We have put an 8% increase for health in here, because our rates should come in the first, you know, the first part of November. So 8% just as an estimate. 3% for dental and non-union staff. 3% increases, just as a placeholder.
Okay.
We tried to put some guesstimate markers in there, just so the number would be a little bit closer to where we're ending up. We met with Rich a number of times and discussed adding more detail to the budget. If you find that there are lines that you still question as to the detail, please let us know, and we may have an opportunity to break some of those out even further. What we're looking for tonight basically is any reactions to the budget setup, any questions that you may have, and then by the time we get to the next meeting, we should have a much, much tighter budget than the number that we've got.
I have gone through and put some notes in on the different lines that have either increased or decreased, or some of the maintenance lines. Rich had given me some detail, so all of the things that were budgeted for in there, I put those in the notes as well. Just to give you some, you know, reasons behind why they increased. The retirement rates did change for this year, or for next year.
It's a
two-year thing, which they weren't that bad. So employees went from 11.38% this year to 11.17% next year, so that decreased a little bit. And teachers' rate went from 17.36% for the current year to 17.8% next year. So really not that bad.
Not those big jumps we've seen in the past.
No, not bad at all. Okay. So those are reflected in here.
And those are in there. Okay. Yep. So we're giving them the time.
So if you look down like the first page, I said, but we're breaking it out. So there is a general supply line, that is the basic general supplies, but there also is one for reading, for art, for music, you know, so we're trying to break those things out. Some of them may not have a dollar in the amount in there right now because we're still working on those figures, but at least the account number is there. So I've given codes, so at the end you can see, it's still the 1,106.10 line, but the 61 now means reading. And the 63 means art, so those are, you know, general art.
We've tried to do the same thing with new equipment, replace equipment. Same thing in the past, there was one kind of catch-all and it was difficult to find the history, number one, and to find out exactly what we budgeted for. So you'll see that, you know, anything over $100 and has a lifespan of more than 3 years should be under equipment. So you'll see that if there's a piece of equipment for art or music or wherever, we're budgeting it in the appropriate area.
Yeah, so on page two, you'll see we used to have one line for computer hardware for technology up at the top, 1,105,734. Now we have two lines, one for new equipment and one for a replacement of equipment. So any new equipment we buy, we'll put in new, and anything that we're replacing, you know, year to year, if we're buying, you know, replacing our computers or things like that, it'll go in those lines. So it's just a little bit of a different breakout.
It reflects more accurately on what we're talking about.
Once we get all of the numbers in, obviously Katie and Rich and I are going to sit down and literally go line by line down through the budget and make sure that we tidy it up before you. We want you to, in your November meeting, to have a pretty tidy number of that stuff.
Okay, and one that we'll have ahead of time to look at before we can one question, and I think I even actually asked it the last time we were reviewing budgets, as I look at things like the audit services, you know, the last actual audit was over what we budgeted, and we still aren't budgeting that amount in our current budget for our budget for next year. So is that the type of thing that
I'll look at that.
You take a look at? And I think there was one or two other things like that too, but I know that one I went back to look at right now because I wanted to make sure that we don't expect that to go down.
Yeah.
As you move through this, if you see any particular lines that you feel are under budgeted, like you just mentioned, or over budgeted, just shoot us an email and we'll certainly check into it. Like I said, we want to try to get these numbers as possible.
So that's good. And the email for folks on the board, they don't have to go through me, but you know, we should, if you get sort of an FYI to Katie and Rob, but copy the rest of the board so we don't duplicate each other.
Because we have found some of that in reviewing budgets that we've seen lines that were annually either under budgeted or over budgeted, and we're trying to clean those up.
That's crazy.
You know, if the audit's a good example of that. I mean, if we're spending $12,000, $13,000, $14,000 every year, then we should budget for that instead of just knowingly going in and we're $3,000 in the hole already.
You utilities too, I wanted to reach out to Dick about those too, because oil, I noticed we went over last year.
As the price started going back.
Yeah, so I wanted to check with him on those estimates as well, so.
Good, that's good. And I assume electricity may also be affected.
Yeah.
Good, and that is, as we all know, as remind all the board here, it's very difficult because we're looking forward a full year. And it's really hard to do, we don't have much experience this year yet, we don't know what's going to happen with the price of utilities and things, so it's crystal balls, we're really going to.
Well, that's why we're hoping when we get everything in the correct line, year after year after year, then we'll be able to do a 3-year running average on something like electricity that's going to give us you're always going to get little spikes. But if you do a running 3-year average, usually you'll be pretty close.
Regarding maintenance, is Dick putting together sort of a list of things that are going to need to be done specifically?
Well, if you look on page 9 of this printout, the items that he budgeted for are listed in the notes section. So far, I know there's more that are going to be coming, but. Although I think this is everything on your list except for the amounts. I didn't have some of the amounts. So the budget number might change, but the notes itself won't. So those are the items.
Tom, are you talking for next year's budget or for the future?
No, for next year.
Yeah.
So they're listed under either grounds maintenance or maintenance repairs. Those were the two items.
And a lot of these look forward to addressing ongoing problems so that we don't have a big, like replacing windows, piecemeal, that kind of thing that he's been doing. So anyway, go ahead, Tom.
Well, along those lines, I noticed that there's lines that look like, or shades that look like they're just torn. No, yeah, it is down there, I'm sorry.
I know we all were using the ends. I didn't think it was there, but.
I noticed them just before we had the open house, and it looks like they've been like that for a while. I just didn't know if there was some sort of a running list of things. I mean, clearly it's not functional. So, also, I'm just curious how people open those windows in that room.
The original.
Where fun time is. How are those windows open? So if it's summertime or if it's.
You stand on a chair and.
And usually with more than one person, correct? Aren't they very heavy?
I can't reach them. I don't want to see other people open the cage.
So that just brings up my question. Somebody gets hurt trying to open a window because they have to climb up onto something. That doesn't really make much sense to me. I don't know how old those windows are, but
I think that's a good point, that if there's anything like that that you think about, fire us out an email, and we can get some prices on that, and then once we get all the numbers in, then you've got some decisions to make. Do you pull something like that out and put it in a warrant article? Right. Do you do it out of unexpected funds?
Well,
do you say we just can't handle it?
I guess my part of the question is whether or not that's just an isolated thing. You know, if it's one or two windows that need to be replaced or fixed or something, but it just seems like somebody could really get hurt trying to open a window, especially if it's very warm. And the shades, if the shades need to come down. The one shade I saw over there was basically, there's a string around it, it's like tied in place. I don't know how that works, but I don't know how long it's been like that. But I don't know how we prioritize, how we list those things. Do they go through each room to look and see?
I mean, my suggestion is we keep a running list, we get the cost, and then we decide what we can, like I said, you've got some options of either putting it into your budget, doing a separate warrant article, doing it out of unexpended surplus at the end of the year, or basically saying, we can't handle that right now.
And in terms of the windows in the original building, they've been a part of almost every engineering study that we've done, and every single study has said they need to be replaced. They don't work, or they work with a great deal of difficulty and they put people at risk to do them. So I think they're in our long-range plan. They may not be, but those should be indeed looked at.
I just, you know, when we're putting this stuff together, you know, it's budget time, and before we know it, it'll be the end of the year. Do we keep sort of a run list of things that, you know, people like walk around, it's Dick walk around each of the classrooms, Rich to walk around the classrooms to see, you know, we really need to do this, you know. I'm not talking about major things, but the small things, they all kind of add up. I mean, we want to make everybody's experience here good, especially if we have an open house, schools in Chatham. So we want to make sure that we, you know, always have it looking its best. At, you know, at the end of the year when we have funds to do things like that, it just makes sense.
No, keeping a list makes a lot of sense because then you can be more proactive in what you're doing instead of reacting when something breaks and then you can finally fix it. So.
And these may not be all, you know, functional things, but stuff that needs to get done, especially, you know, when we're at the end of the year, when there aren't any kids in the schools, it's not to get the stuff done without, you know, getting away.
So my impression is that they are really doing well.
But to Tom's point, anything that once we, I think he's done a nice, Dick's done a nice job of getting this together. If anything comes out, let's say that we need to get our number down for a final budget. If anything comes out, that's the list that we need to let not lose sight of. You know, because that's the list we can hopefully attend to in different ways.
And also to Tom's point, we all have different sensibilities. All of us, we all walk around, and some of us would pick out the shades, and some of us would pick out that little peeling piece of paint or something, and we'd all pick out different things. So whatever any of us sees, we need to shoot a note over there, and whatever else, Dick, and we would welcome, Rich, you asking staff things that, you know, they've lived with for 20 years because it's still functioning, but it's difficult to work around. I mean, you know, let's get that list. I mean, let's...
I don't know if he has a long-range written list or not. I know that there are two different things you're talking about. These are more bigger ticket maintenance repairs. Like, they might be a one-time thing or one-time for 10 or 15 years. And then you're talking the day-to-day. A shade, to me, is something that can come out of this year's budget if we haven't overspent the budget.
Right.
And he does pick away at those things.
Yeah.
But, you know.
It almost feels like we need to have, like, $1,000 in the miscellaneous so that there's kind of like a slush fund. So if something, if a,
no.
I mean, like if a shade breaks, you can go buy a new shade,
There is general maintenance money in the budget because, you know, every year there's going to be general maintenance needs. And there's nothing specifically earmarked for that. It's on an as-needed basis that year.
We have five, six or seven more minutes, so other thoughts, questions on this, looking at this. Just as a general suggestion, and I would, and please anyone else jump in here on this, I don't see why we can't combine middle and high school instead of having two different breakouts for it. I mean, it's all Marshallwood, tuition's the same for each one, but if people think it's better to leave it as middle and high.
Does that help you?
Does it help?
And that's how it was always given to you in the past, so I wanted to give you what you were doing.
And we did see it that way, but I'm just wondering how
it's completely up to
that way cuts down a little bit.
It's completely up to you.
Yeah, I guess as far as transportation or any of those costs, that's all together anyway.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, they're broken out.
They're broken out now.
Well, does Marshwood break it out?
They don't break out.
We break it out here.
Yeah, but if it was just, we'd still want it broken out, RGS and Marshwood.
Put one report from Middle and High, I can do that.
If people agree, I don't want to. You're wondering still. Emily's still wondering, don't they?
I think what you wanted is basically RGS separate.
Yeah, yes.
You know, the ability to, but I can put the other two on one more page, that's fine.
Yeah, I guess now that we're fully transitioned.
Yep.
What was the budget committee doing, Karen?
It saves you, I don't know if it saves you any time, if it doesn't matter to you, or.
No, I mean, they're set up as two reports now, but it's literally a click of a button to add the middle school to the high school report. It's really not that difficult, so whatever you guys want is fine with me.
Yeah, I think the important piece is that to explain to the general public that if you're reducing your budget, your overall budget, basically you're reducing from this building.
Yeah.
You know, that's the important piece of splitting that out, because you're paying tuition, special education, transportation. I mean, a lot of those are fixed numbers every year. And they're based on your student population, where at the elementary school, you've got more control over your budget. So if you're reducing your overall budget, it's coming out of here.
Good point. So that's
completely up to you, just let me know. So put it together.
And the only other thing I wanted to bring up, because I don't want us to lose sight of this, it's something that we spent a lot of the last 4 or 5 years talking about and getting to a good point. And I think we're still at a good point, but again, we need professional input on this. And that is making sure that we're right-sizing our staff. We want to make sure that the superintendent and the principal realize that we consider that an ongoing look at things. I mean, right now we have whatever it is, 160 students just under at the Rollinsford Grade School. And you know, we need your advice as to whether we're right sized or not. We would love to be what some people might consider overstaffed, but we can't afford to be overstaffed. So the point is just to try to keep us at a good staff level.
Well, I think that's an annual discussion, you know, looking at your class size, looking at your bubbles. You're going to have some big classes going through, you're going to have some small classes going through, looking at, you know, what is appropriate adjusting for that. Because I agree, you don't want to be overstaffed, but at the same time, you want to make sure that you're offering appropriate services. So we'll take a look at that every year.
No, we're having a budget workshop. You're free to join.
I second the motion for next removal.
And we should need another chair for Megan as well. So.
How are you?
Let's see more apart. Other thoughts and anything we'd like to see differently? It's really good to go through this.
If you have any questions, as you look through it on the notes or anything.
The other thing is that I know that you put in 3% as a placeholder for non-union staff. We have historically done pretty much what the town does, and that has historically been 2%, but we'll wait and see what that affects.
Yeah, we've put in a few markers. If you want the markers different for anything, just let us know.
And hopefully by the November meeting, we'll have our health insurance rate, so that'll be very helpful, rate, hopefully.
That would be very helpful. All right, any other? Well, thank you for getting this work together for our preliminary discussion.
I'm not sure it's
children that are playing quietly in the hallway that I don't want to disturb. Celia Leopold, with the recent articles that came out about the summer for high school, I was wondering if this board already had a strategic plan or if that was something they were working on, and whether or not you would put some of the information that you would like the public to know out in one of your FAQs that you do.
Thank you for the comment. Any other comments from visitors or questions that we may address later or not? Any other comments? All right, we'll move on then. Consent calendar is comprised of two joint policy meetings, and we have I'll just say a little bit about that. We have historically held joint policy meetings with Summersworth because the policies are primarily the same. Very, very seldom is there anything different between policies between the two school districts. I am a representative, and I was not available for either of those meetings. So there are the notes from those meetings, the minutes from those meetings, which is good. The minutes from our last school board meeting and the enrollment. What is the pleasure of the board on the consent calendar?
I move to accept the consent calendar as written.
Second.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Passes. All right, the superintendent's update.
All right, I've just got a couple of things, and some of them are on your agenda already. We've got an update on the cupola and a quote on that, and that's already on your agenda, so that's coming up shortly. I have two, at the end, I have two things for non-public, staff-related, so we can go into non-public and discuss those at the end. The other piece I have is to address the couple of the articles in the paper and to give you a little bit of an update as your superintendent. The Summersworth Joint Commission, which is the city council as well as the school board, met a couple of weeks ago, and it was on their agenda for withdrawal from SAE 56 as a discussion item. So that took place, and then on October 9th, this past Tuesday evening, it was an agenda item on the Summersworth School Board to, as a discussion item, to discuss withdrawing from SAU 56. At this point, it was a discussion item. They had a rather lively discussion, and there wasn't any decisions made at this point. It's going back on their next agenda on October 23rd as an action item. So how that will turn out, I mean, you know, wait and see. But I just wanted to let you know that that was out there. It's part of a discussion, and it's going to be on their agenda as an action item on October 23rd.
Thank you.
While I have no comments, or observations to make on what Bob has just said, I think we've all read the articles in the paper. I don't think there's any reason for us to have any action plan or do anything until we know more of what's going to happen, if anything. I do have a couple clarifications, though, that I would like to just state tonight for the town and all of us to hear. Rawlinsford School Board has never had input into the oversight of Summersworth Schools or the school district. Not when we had students there. Not when we didn't have students there, we've never had any input into how Summersworth runs their schools, and that was said in the paper, so I wanted to sort of set that straight. And the SAU board, Rawlinsford holds 5 of 14 seats, so I also wanted to point out that if you take pure math, it's 36%, and that SAU board only oversees SAU functions. It oversees no Summersworth school or school district functions. I just wanted to make those clarifications of what's been in the paper. Thank you, Bob. Do you have anything else, Bob?
That's all I have for my report. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone have questions for Bob on that? Communications, I think we're... All right, well, tonight we have our full complement of Marshwood student reps here tonight. Nicholas Garapi, who we met last month, and
And tonight joining us is Megan Moore, so we have two. Megan's at the end of the table there waving. We will have nameplates once I remember where I put the holders. So tonight we're going to get the updates for that, and from both of them on whatever they would like to report on. So, Megan, why don't we start with you? You can, if you would introduce yourself, say a few words about yourself, and then tell us whatever you'd like to tell.
My name is Freddie Moore. I'm a senior at Arthur High. I'm the captain of the JV Marshall Girls soccer team. I'm more involved with sports and everything else. I take honors classes. I'm part of the National Honor Society. I'm also part of the Spanish National Honor Society. And tonight I'm going to take more of a back seat and just kind of watch how Nick kind of does the updates. And then I do know a couple things. There's a senior night tomorrow night for girls soccer and for girls volleyball, if anybody would like to attend. And I believe October 13th is the MHS band show in Color Guard. It'll be at 5 p.m. in the gym at Marshall High, and that's always fun to watch because it's actually very interesting.
So what is a senior night that people can go to?
Senior night is for all seniors that play sports. So if, for example, I play soccer, so tomorrow I'll play my JV game, and then all the seniors come out before the game starts for the varsity game. It's at 6 p.m. And they hand out flowers to their parents, and they just get announced, and they get pictures, and there's like a whole, it's just a fun night to let celebrate the seniors last year.
Thank you. Thank you. And now, Nick.
Okay. I kind of made a list of things that have happened in the past month since we last met. Just kind of update. There's six things. First, student government began for the school. Student government is a club at the school. It's not like anything formal with like elections. And they meet two Mondays every month as like a big group. And they're split into different committees. There's the student life committee, which kind of focuses on what's going on with the students around the school, the green committee, which focuses more on like the environment, wellness committee. They organize our wellness day every year where we have a guest speaker. There's a different theme every year. I'm not sure what the theme is, but there's a different guest speaker every year. Peer tutoring committee, they get peer tutors from around the school, usually kids that like excel in different classes. And they kind of help out other kids that might be struggling. And then the Civil Rights Committee, they really focus on making sure everyone kind of feels at home at Marshwood and make sure everyone feels equal. I did attend one of the meetings. I joined the Student Life Committee. I feel like that would be the work that kind of gets me the most involved with the student body. So I wanted to try that one out. The second thing, we do have multiple Danish exchange students. I don't really have a lot to say on that. Do you have anything to say about that?
They were here for the weekend for our Spirit Week, and they were there for our pep rally, and everything. It was kind of just like a little weekend thing that like Marshwood sends kids over, and they just get to experience. It's like we send kids over there, and then they send kids over here, and it's just like a nice little exchange interview. And then we also have, I'm pretty sure, a Greek exchange student that's here for the whole year, and then we have a couple of Spanish exchange students as well.
She knows more about that than me, I guess.
They were also at a homecoming dance, so I met them there as well.
Do you want to talk about Spirit Week as well?
Yes, Spirit Week. I believe seniors went Spirit Week again. Third year in a row for my class. I'm very proud. It was really fun, and there was a lot of attendance. A couple kids got dress coded in multiple grades, but it was just because they were too rallying. Like seniors wore really, really short jean shorts. The guys, the football team, yes. It was just really interesting, but it was all fun all around. And a lot of kids showed up to pack the stands, so you get points to come see sports and everything, and that was really fun. Our homecoming football game, I believe we won 49-7 versus Noble.
like excellent spirit, and when did dress code become a verb?
We made it a verb.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Get dress coded.
It really only happens during spirit week. Like, kids get, like, one girl had a bandana as a shirt.
Opportunities to go to local libraries and help out. So Megan's part of that, so she probably knows more.
Yeah, it's really fun. We just elected our class officers. I can't think of it off the top of my head, but it's not like a president, like vice president. It's just like all officers. I'm not an officer, but it's more or less just like helping induct the new. The kids into the program that usually happens around 15-ish. Around is when they get inducted, and then you need at least 1 hour of community service once you're inducted to scan books at South Berwick Public Library. You scan books and help them. We help them out a lot, like wood bake sales and their big book sale in May. And community service is a big thing for them. Like if you don't have at least your school requirements, most of the time it's harder to get in that way. But it's not required, but it's highly encouraged. So if anybody wants to do that, that's a really fun thing to do.
That's very nice. And perhaps they could also consider including New Orleans for library as a place for service.
Okay, yeah, we have a meeting, I think.
That'd be great. And Emily could provide more information. Emily, Megan, you could provide more information if necessary. She's connected to the library, too. So.
Okay. Two more things. PSATs were yesterday. It's always fun to sit down for 3 hours and take tests. But the PSAT is a qualifying test for the National Merit Scholarship Program, which is a $2,500 scholarship. And it's only awarded to 7,500 people out of 1.6 million. So it's really tough to get. And it's also just a good practice for the SAT. And at Marshwood, the SAT is given on SAT School Day, which is, this year's April 9th, I believe. But it's pretty much the day. Some states require it, others don't. But the SAT will be given to the schools, and they'll pretty much give it to the students for free. So you don't have to pay, you don't have to... you don't have to like travel anywhere to take it. Usually you have to travel. And it's not required in Maine that happens, but at Marshwood it does. So that's good. And the last thing, I talked to the Marshwood School Board rep for the junior class that represents like at the Marshwood School Board meetings. Mm-hmm. And we haven't talked about anything to do with school board stuff yet, but I have that source if that would be helpful.
Excellent. Thank you. Excellent report from both of you. You for not having worked together long. You did an excellent job in sharing the responsibilities. Tonight, any questions or observations from the board?
Or anything that you would like me to go more into.
as usual, you are welcome to stay for the entire meeting, but I also know you're very busy folks, and so you are also free to leave, and we very much appreciate your report. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to backtrack just a moment, but I forgot to ask. I wrote a note and then I forgot to look at it. I meant to ask Bob if we have an update on the statement for the security items.
We do, and that's coming in our financial report.
Wait, I see a smile. Okay, we'll just hold that then. We'll just hold that.
It's coming.
Okay.
We wanted to keep you on the edge of your seat.
That's right.
And so we are. Next, we are on the edge of our seat. Next up is the principal's report, which I know he handed out to us, and I don't know where I put my copy. Here it is. There it is. So would you like to give us the highlights,
sure.
Rich?
So we are almost fully staffed.
Yay.
Yeah, we are down to one mainstream coach position that we're still advertising for, which is a one-on-one paraprofessional.
Okay, so not quite fully staffed then.
Right. So we're almost there, which is actually helpful because, you know, once we are, it releases our substitutes that are filling those positions currently because they are required positions.
Okay.
So we've been stealing from our sub list, and that's causing a little bit of strain on our resources when we have staff going to professional development or starting to get sick in some cases. We did just have our third professional development day last Friday, and the October day is a good day to differentiate professional development based on need. The NEA holds an annual conference in Concord, and a few of our staff members attended that. We had some technology workshops for our paraprofessionals during the morning. Tom Lavell came in and did a two-hour workshop that initial feedback from the staff said went very, very well, and looking forward to more. And Tom is always willing to come in and, you know, give us trainings on anything that we're looking for. But we've also had a couple of other opportunities. Tracy Zager has been a math consultant for the school for a few years. She began her visitations this year on September 25th, going into classrooms, working with teachers around our math implementation. You may or may not realize that despite being multi-age classrooms, we do split kids by grade level for math instruction. It's a much easier time for teachers to cover one math curriculum instead of two separate ones. And that's usually the academic area that you see the greatest discrepancies with students. So she's been in, and we are doing something called a CGI assessment, which is a quick 15 to 20 minute assessment with students. I'm a little unfamiliar with that right now, but our teachers have started giving those this month, and she's going to come back at the end of the month to spend time with each of them to review the data, and help drive their instruction over the winter and spring months, depending on what the students achieved.
And what does CGI stand for?
That's part of what I just realized.
I'm looking at someone else who might know. Well, wait, Becky's trying to come up with it.
Clinical? No.
Cognitive, I think. Guided instruction.
Oh, wait, she just looked it up.
Cognitively guided instruction?
She Googled it. Cognitive guided instruction.
Cognitively guided instruction.
Thank you.
Good thing I found that password out.
Thank you.
And it is given twice a year, once in October and again in March, to help the last 3 months of the school year. And on back, I'll just skip over the buildings and grounds piece. Folks to read yourself, but some of the highlights that we've gone through. Ms. O'Connor's here and would probably share also that our first flu clinic went well, despite it being a little chaotic. Some of our students needed a little extra support.
40 students.
Yeah, we had about 25%, I think, of our school participate.
Yeah.
So for a first time, we had a number of parents thank us for having this opportunity. And, schedule-wise, it's tough getting kids into doctors, or I know a lot of have our first gathering of parents interested in revitalizing our PTO, and we've set up a couple of future meetings. There was more parents of younger age students, so it's a positive step towards the future. You know, hopefully get them to get invested early on and stay with us for a few years and help the PTO grow in numbers. Tomorrow is Fire Safety and Prevention Day, so the Rollinsburg Fire Department is making connections with our community. They're coming in to do some assemblies for our kids, and if the weather cooperates, they do a little muster outside at the end of the day for the kids and get some of the kids involved in showcasing their own skills in a muster activity. And it has been announced that in March, we are performing Zeusical. So Jeannie Powers, Lori Hess, and Brittany Powers have begun working with an excited group of students. Auditions, I think, just finished this week, so they are raring to go and should be a fun time getting ready for a production in the spring.
Sounds like fun. Thank you. Any questions or Rich at the moment?
And I did pass the interview questions back to Aaron. Last month it was suggested that the new administrative staff, Dr. Godomsky, myself, and Allison get interviewed. We had 3 6th grade students that I selected to come interview us, and I got the answers back.
Fantastic, thank you very much. Please thank them for us also.
Oh, they were quite excited.
The kids did a great job.
Yeah, quite excited.
Awesome. Wonderful. I look forward to reading these and work on getting them out to the community.
That's great. Yeah, thank you both for doing that. All right, thank you, Rich. All right, so now we're up to the security renovation presentation. It's time for Chris to...
So, quick recap as to kind of what we were looking at in terms of estimate. We had a couple of options, as you remember last time, three different proposed options. And we'll start with option one. We're looking at, again, moving the main entry to the school off the back for both ADA accessibility and security. You guys all see this? You have plans in your packet as well. So the first option was the slimmest, which is going to show to be the most cost-effective option. May not work quite as well with your program. So the first option was to maintain your existing entry. We're going to add a vestibule. So when you come in, you'll have a vestibule. There'll be a control point where people can then come in to the receptionist and meet. And also the principal will have an office there. So that's really where your control point is once you come into the building, just adding a vestibule. We're not adding anything to the outside of the school. There's going to be a reconfigure of the existing IT space. And since these plans were printed, we did add, which we talked about last time, was this. There's a janitor closet here and a toilet. So we're going to add a door into this space. You'll have a janitor's closet, and you'll also have a spot for the washer and dryer in that space. Plumbing's there. It's all in place. So tapping into those existing facilities would be pretty easy in terms of construction. So again, the nurse, the main entry, and then the receptionist goes into where the teacher's room is. So that's kind of option one. Option two drawbacks to this is it is fairly tight. Come in and then the office here would be efficient. Option two was looking at coming out, adding a vestibule off the back of the school, kind of taking up to where the existing ramp was, adding a new vestibule. People will be able to come in. Again, this is your control point. Beginning end of the day, these doors will be open for students to come in and out. Then once school day starts, your main entry door currently would be locked. People would be able to come into the vestibule, check in with the receptionist, and then if you were permitted into the school, you could enter, or you could come right in and meet with the principal and back out. So that was option two. We didn't price this option. We priced option one and option three, kind of the least expensive and most expensive. You can see where we were. Nurse space shakes out the same way as well. And option three was, we looked at, what if we did come into the side of the, so out this side. So one of the drawbacks of the other two options was your main entry is kind of around the side of the school. We're going to work with the canopies and kind of reconfiguring that entry to signify that, you know, this is an entry. But is there a better option to have the entrance right off of the side street? So that option comes in to underneath the new canopy, come up into the building through this sidewall into a new vestibule where you can then come into the principal's main office. The principal has an office. There's also another conference room, print copy room, and then again we have this conference room down the end. And then the nurse space plays out the same way. So that would be the most expensive option because, again, we're adding the most amount of square footage. It seemed to work pretty well with your program, getting a conference room, getting a couple of offices, flexibility down the road, and then a print room. So with that, we also looked at, if you were to reconfigure down here, teacher's room, et cetera, into this new office, reconfiguring the current main office into the teacher's room and some employee bathrooms. So again, we take up the existing principal's office and receptionist, turn that into a conference room, as well as that would be the teacher's room. So kind of multi-use, or it could be a small group classroom during the day. Print copy room off the side, and also a kitchenette pulled off the side. So this space could really be a flexible multi-use space, getting the stove and refrigerator out of the actual teacher's room itself, and then having two additional bathrooms for staff over there is what we looked at. So with that, we go to the cost estimates, and you see we have a full kind of breakdown further in the packet, but the first option we looked at, the most conservative approach, the construction cost for that would be roughly $219,000. That would be for just the entry and the reconfiguration of that space. And then the teacher's room renovations in that front space would be another $128,000 to a total of $348,000. Like you said, you could just do this back part and then kind of make do with what's up there. There's a partition in between the principal's office and the main entry. You could just leave that as is. Teacher's room could adapt to that space, so you don't have to do those. And then your soft costs, in addition to that, architectural engineering fees, civil engineering, if there's any reconfiguration up front, out back, furnishings, fixtures, AV, security, alarms, moving, legal fees, and then owner contingency. So that would be a contingency for you, say if the scope changes or if you were to add stuff to the project. The total for that would be another $113,000, the total project price of $462,000. With that, we have, at this point, we sent more developed plans than this to the estimator, but we can have a full set of construction documents. So the estimator made some kind of contingencies built into this price. So they have, if you see down on the bottom, the construction costs include 20% general conditions. So that would be everything from the job trailer to the porta potties, storage unit, fencing, all that kind of goes into the general conditions. 12% for construction management and profit and overhead. So that would be if you hired a construction manager, that would be their profit. We're seeing school projects like this running anywhere from 6 to 10%. So again, this is at the estimating point, so a couple extra percentages in there. because this is such a small project, there's an adjustment for that because you're not getting economy of scale. So they made that contingency. Get a design cost contingency because we're only at schematics. So that's that. Right now, there's a 15% contingency in terms of the project price. So once we get the final construction documents, it's thought that, you know, that would come back down. So that 15% will come out. Inflation, because we're not building it right now. We're going to be building it in the future. And then again, there's some market uncertainties. So it's kind of hard to know. And then bond and insurance. So those contingencies are all built into the price.
They're built into the current price.
Yeah. So, but at this point, you know, this is how we keep it as accurate as possible. Mm-hmm. That being said, typically the cost estimator, you know, these numbers are pretty spot on when it comes to the construction. We happen to do a $20 million project and use $100,000 off. So that's kind of how close they can get at this phase. You know, these numbers should be within 5 to 10% of the actual construction price once we move down the road. So the third option should be, again, the more developed option coming in to the side, and more square footage that we're adding. So this whole section here would be an addition. Again, and then there's a new canopy. We do have some money in this budget for reconfiguring some parking. How the parking kind of steps in here would be adding 3 parking spaces as well. We just have it in there. If it's not needed, then we'll leave parking as is.
Was that thought because you're going to be taking out 3 parking spaces?
Yeah, yeah. Taking out, we're going to add those back in. So we want to make sure we had that accounted for. So for this option, the total renovations and additions for the back would be $538,000. And then the teacher's room addition up front, that would be another $128,000, bringing the total price to $667,000. And then again, you have your soft costs added into that, between AE fees, civil engineering, moving, security, owner contingency, the $170,000, with a total project price of $837,000. So that's with kind of both components of the project. So and then further in your packet, you have a kind of a full breakdown. You can see there's all these small lines, and you need a magnifying glass to see it, but of kind of all the line items they went through to develop this estimate. So that's kind of where we are with the budget. Next steps for us would be, if we have an idea of which option you guys would want to move forward with, we could then go out and get a construction manager to join the team, contingent on a bond vote pass, and they could do another more refined cost estimate, and then marketing for any type of bond go from there. So any questions?
I just wonder if you could tell me, we talked about on the first configuration, the principal reception area. I know you have dimensions on here, but comparing that size to the current principal
be, it's definitely smaller than the office right now.
It would, so in this first configuration would be smaller
than the current office right now.
And the current principal's office? I thought it was really hard to get smaller than that.
Well, it's,
really,
it's more narrow.
It's 114 square feet, so that's a standard size office. For a normal office. That being said, they're not going to have space for a conference room table in that. So that would be 114 square feet.
Okay.
So that would be the only drawback to that. I mean, you could have a small desk in the corner, which I haven't been into your office. But you know, Kate, she had kind of a desk pushed up against the wall. You'd have enough space for people to meet in there, but you wouldn't have a space for a desk and a table.
But here, with this configuration, you'll have the reception area too, is what you're saying.
Yes, yep.
But also, this is more square. So it's actually.
That's a mind position.
It'll feel.
Yeah, the proportions of that space is, a lot of it's unusable. It's kind of circulation space because it is such a long, narrow space, so they have more usable space.
Figure it out next time.
nice seeing you guys in more architectural style and presentation style plans too. Civil engineering, furnishings, fixtures, a lot of that was focused on that main entry. But yes, those figures would go down.
And I think up until this point, all the costs are covered with the original agreement we had with you, I think, mm-hmm. correct? Does the next step require an additional amount of money?
Yeah, I'd have to go back and look at kind of how many hours it would take, but I mean, it wouldn't be a significant.
And by that, you know, contracting the construction.
Yep. Oh, yeah. So going into the construction items yeah. would be more, yeah.
For them to do their work.
Yeah, a lot of times. In this economy, you probably need to pay them to do that and to get a good estimate out of them. But we have a solid estimate right now. Mm-hmm. And you could go to bond vote with these and then hire a construction manager afterwards. In harder times, when people are a little bit hungrier, they'd be able to come on and get free estimating services out of them. We're seeing that those estimating services really don't mean much because nobody has the time to put into it. So you get what you pay for that. So
it's an honest answer, obviously.
Yeah.
And in these times, that you're right, things have changed.
People are busy, and there's work out there. So for them to come on and do free estimating services, they're going to not put as much time into it. But you could go, appropriate the funds, and then have an RFP for a construction manager, and then develop the drawings at that point as well.
Okay. Other questions? Certainly have our discussions, and we will have discussions.
Okay.
Thank you. We appreciate all you've done and laying out the options you see there. So, and obviously the option number two, the concept number two, falls somewhere in between these.
Yep.
Obviously, so. All right.
And again, these are right now it's lines on a page, so we can change stuff, rework stuff, look at the costs again, whatever we can. Do to help.
All right. Thank you very much, Chris.
Thank you.
So, in front of you, would you like to speak to this?
Sure, just I guess a little background. You remember that late last school year, early summer, there was an estimate for about $7,500. You're going to see some wildly different estimates in the type of work that you get done on the cupola. We had talked about bringing it back to historical relevance and somewhere in the $75,000 to $100,000 range. Obviously, which would be going every nail, every board, everything. The $7,500 estimate was basically to pin the boards back on and paint it to get it visually looking better. This one's for $2,100. It is $21,000. Sorry, $21,000. Which obviously is somewhere in the middle. It's getting addressing some of the structural issues, putting on some new boarding, and revamping it, painting it. So you know, that's the difference in the estimates that we're getting back. At this point in time, obviously $21,000 is a pretty big chunk to take out of your budget to say go ahead this year. I don't feel comfortable at this point in time in recommending that. I guess my recommendation would be to revisit this as we get into the spring. We can get new quotes at that point, and then we will also know, you know, in the March, April, May time frame, you'll know where your budget stands and if there's any unexpended funds that might be an opportunity for that. And the other option, well, a couple of different options, you can always put it into your budget for next year, budget the sum of money, we could do that, and then if we have unexpended funds and take it out of this year, then obviously you'd have that extra in your budget. And the other option would be to do a warrant article for X number of dollars, and if it passes, you would have that available to do the cupola. Just remember, if you put it in a warrant article and it fails, no means no, and can't fix it with any money as you might have. So that's just a kind of a brief update.
Thoughts?
Is it still hanging on? Okay.
Last I looked, it was still up there.
So. It's wrapped in chicken wire. I mean, yeah.
How about other quotes? The option of getting more quotes. At least give us an idea.
It's been very
good. Maybe if it falls somewhere in between.
It's been very difficult to even get quotes, as you heard from Chris. Everybody's got work now, and that was part of our issue this summer. It was like pulling teeth to even get quotes on it in the first place. Plus, you know, this time of year we're running out of decent weather, so.
Well, I'm not
going
there with
this.
I mean, one of the things that, of course, is different between the $7,500 and this quote is that this is much more detailed as to what they're going to do, and it does sort of split the difference of putting it sort of back. I mean, they say it right there. They state right there as close to original condition as possible, and that's, I think that's what we would want to aim for.
I think as long as it's safe and it looks reasonably
good,
yeah.
Right.
That's kind of
safe
what
and looks
going
good.
For.
Right. Mm-hmm. Safe and looks like it belongs, not
yeah.
not made out of plastic or
solid. Yes, right.
Or maybe
that actually might be or
maybe,
the right way to go.
Or maybe yes, made out of the stuff that looks
it
like
might actually be cheaper and it would last a lot longer.
I would tell from the
ground. Yeah, it's hard to tell. Well, those are things we can discuss. So I agree with Bob that $21,000 is a lot to encumber right now. It may not be in another few months, and so we'd have to wait and see. Even as we know, we still don't have tuition figures yet for this year from the other things coming in. So looks like
I think we're ready.
And we'll rediscuss. discuss it, certainly at the time when we decide if we want to use it, do a warrant article or not. I think we will have to make that decision when we get to that point in December, January.
So at this point in time, we'll leave it out of your next year's budget, but just understand that that's part of your discussion and decision making.
Because we actually had decided that we were going to proceed with the work.
With the $7,500, yes.
Right, it was at a different price, obviously.
And if it were $7,500, I think that would, you know, that might still be viable, but it's not. It's another $15,000 on top of it, almost. Three times that, so.
So then what's this, what's $7,000 estimate?
Oh, that's, you'll notice that's the payment schedule?
Payment schedule.
Oh, I didn't turn the page over.
But, I mean, that's how they're saying payment, $7,000.
Gotcha. Thank you.
And one of the things we do have to keep in mind, as an example, Chris, as an example, other things we've seen happening in town, water and sewer has had, you know, they've had to raise salaries to bring qualified people in to do the work. And this is one of the downsides of a good economy. And the unemployment rate at where it is, so.
We've found that in all of the trades, whether it's electrician, construction, plumbing, it is difficult to get people in now. They've got so much work. They just don't have enough staff. They've got too much work. It's a challenge.
So while we're unhappy, we are now going to put this aside and keep it, but keeping it very much in the fore of our minds as we move forward with budget and other things. So we are not taking any action on the COLA this evening. All right, we are up to the financial update. So we have the first part of it is the budget update. That's our current budget, correct?
So it's included in your packet. This month I did add like a little memo, because I know Emily mentioned the last one. We kind of put the budget in here, but we don't really have an explanation as to things that have happened since the last one, so I have done that, so it's in there now. So basically what changes, we did encumber some of the items that we talked about the last meeting, transportation audit, trash removal, after school transportation, the SAT assessment, things like that we know we're going to spend. When I wrote this report, I said I was still waiting for the tuition bill. I did receive it this week, so Pam and I are working on it to look at the kids that were being billed for and costing that out. So the next report, it will be encumbered on the next report.
Okay, so you received the special ed?
Both.
You received both. And we should be receiving each monthly, correct?
Yeah, we do.
I know it doesn't always work out that way.
Yeah, so I did receive it, so that next time it will be all encumbered.
Okay.
So we'll see where we stand with that.
You're going to encumber it month by month, or you're going to project?
I'm going to encumber the whole year, based on the kids on the first bill, and then I'll adjust it every month if kids change.
Excellent, thank you. That seems
good. So that's it. I haven't done special ed transportation yet because I'm awaiting figures from special ed on that. So that will hopefully by the next meeting I'll have that as well, because that's one area where I am concerned about, just because last year we were over by quite a bit by the end of the year. So I want to keep an eye on that. As far as the revenue goes, you'll see we did receive that $2,500 reimbursement from the Preservation Alliance. Because the expense happened in a prior year, we have to recognize it as other revenue, so it's showing on your revenue side. Also in revenue, included in your packet, we did receive the revised estimates from the state regarding adequacy. So we did have a drop in adequacy of just about $16,000. However, kindergarten aid came after you guys prepared your budget last year, so we did budget at zero for kindergarten aid, so we're getting 25.6. So those offset each other, basically, so you're actually getting $10,000 more than you had estimated.
Do we know why adequacy was
Well, you know, it's funny I gave a sheet with this one, the outline between the estimate, it didn't make it in the packet for some reason, so I will send that to you.
I mean, I know it's like 15 things?
Yeah, there's a whole spreadsheet, and what I did is a comparison from the estimate to now to see where you're changing it, didn't make it in the packet, so I'll get that to you.
I have the comparison.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
It wasn't in my packet.
No, why it was reduced.
Yeah, this.
I have it like the estimate based on all the factors of the kids calculated.
This is the final.
I will get that for you because I should give it to be put in here, but it didn't make it.
But there's no, nothing you can pinpoint to say, oh, we have.
Well, you'll see the fluctuations if, you know, on the different areas between, you know, APM and the free and reduced lunch and the different calculations, you'll see where it changed.
Okay.
I will get that for you. I'm sorry I didn't make it in here.
And one last question, is this liable to change again since it's still an estimate? Does it change again by the end of the year or does it not?
Usually the estimate that they give us comes out pretty close. This estimate.
This estimate.
Not the first one, this estimate.
Okay.
I suppose it could fluctuate slightly, but usually this one's pretty close.
Okay.
So the minus 16 is not in there yet, right?
No, because the tax rate hasn't been set yet. So what will happen is the DRA will call me and they'll say, these are your revised revenues, and then we'll adjust the revenues, and then once that happens, I will adjust them in the budget. That will happen when the tax rate gets set.
Right, and that's usually set in November.
Yeah, I mean, all of my stuff is in, so I'm not sure what the holdup is, but, So that's my budget update. The public infrastructure funds.
Yes.
We did receive notice on October 4th that we were approved to receive the funding, so not to exceed $50,794.
And
we got it, so we're approved.
Woo!
However, again, because we paid these items last year, it is going to come in as other revenue. So that's how it's going to come in and be posted. So part of this process for reimbursement is the board has to sign an affidavit stating that we spent the money and the project is completed and it was all spent. So I have done that for you guys to sign. So, I mean, you already know we spent it on the phone and bell system, the windows and door, the doors. Yeah, all of that. I have everything here for you if you want to look at it before you sign the affidavit. I have all the invoices and everything for you. So that's great news that we did receive.
And does it, and it covers
80% of the cost. Yep. So our portion was $12,698.44.
A lot of work. A lot of work for everybody following up on that and everything. So thank you for all that.
You're welcome.
So before you leave tonight, if we can
get you to sign off on that, then we can get it in
for the paper.
Well, that's really good news. Thank you. So it's good to have that. So any other budget related questions?
We did finalize your budget timeline. It's also in your packet. So if that is acceptable, we tried to adjust it according to the discussion that you had last time.
Yes, well, I do have something to bring up about that. If I just have to find that one piece of paper, that I'm sure I put somewhere. Here it is. So on the budget timeline, we as a board did decide when we would hold the deliberative session. However, we also have a few other people who I don't believe it's actually even our meeting. I think the school district moderator gets to weigh in on this.
Oh.
And we haven't found out if he's available, nor the town clerk, which also has to be available to identify people who can vote and raise their, you know, because they need to vote. So we have a little homework left to do. Also checking with the budget committee, making sure, you know, just sort of running through those things. So Emily, when is the next budget committee meeting? Is it next week?
24.
24. So I know we have to finalize this very quickly.
Yes.
And I don't know what we would do if we can't do it that way. So what would you
like me to reach out to the moderator and to the clerk to see if they're available?
That might work well.
It's up to you.
I mean, I'm happy to do it also as the chair and copy you and Bob on it. Why don't I do that? I'll write the email, copy you too, as well as the moderator and the clerk. And then, you know, in terms of the budget committee, it's a matter of, you know, hopefully they'll be able to show up and be part of it as well. So, but also to run that by them, but probably wait till the next meeting unless we want to reach out to them before that.
Meeting's on the 24th.
Yeah, it's not that far away. And we'll hope for the best on that. That came to me, I believe, in Lincoln, Nebraska. that we have not yet reached out to.
I'm just wondering, should you maybe approve it pending the, that everybody else can do it, seeing we're not meeting again until November 8th? It, I mean, it's up to you, but it might speed, you know, it might help us.
Yeah, so we don't have to, we don't have to do it again. We just say as long as they're available.
Motion to approve the dates listed here too, pending approvals by all the appropriate parties.
Particularly the school district moderator and the town clerk.
If you want to list all of
them. All right, well, it's the school district moderator in particular and the town clerk.
Okay.
Those two. So, you got that right? You got the motion? And we have a second from Tom. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
I just know we're going to want to get legal counsel to, and they fill out fast. So the sooner we know the date.
Oh, absolutely. But I didn't have legal counsel on my list. All right. So I the email will go out tomorrow to those you guys. All right. Any other budget questions or information? I did have a question on our on the school board services expenditure. We've already expended $3,259.08. School spring. All right, thank you.
Yeah, that's your last year.
That was last year.
Could be last year.
But it might be
this
year.
I'll look into
I thought it was last year, but it might be this year. We did it at the end of last
$3,002. That's your New Hampshire School Boards Association dues. That $3,002.
Oh, thank you. Yes, thank you.
That's
all right.
That is.
Thank you.
Wow.
Wow. All right. Thank you.
Anderson.
New business to come before the board. Should we be in the business? Any new business to come before the board? All right, moving on. Old business, community connections.
Yes, so I think we covered this earlier. We have the interview questions. Proceed with writing up some profiles on our new administrators to share with parents and the community, let them get to know you guys a little bit. So we'll work on that.
I think that's great.
Yeah,
wonderful. I can't wait to see them.
I see what all is. That's good.
And it sounds like both Rich and Bob had fun being interviewed.
It was a great time. This student that I interviewed did a wonderful job.
That's good. Future meeting dates. There's another policy. I do want to apologize for not having been around to go to those policy meetings. I will try to catch up in the next couple weeks and hopefully attend that.
Andrea and I both showed up.
Thank you.
We both showed up. Erin was a little conflicted because she wasn't able to go.
No, well, we showed up.
Because I did go to the whole board, and I wasn't sure what that meeting was for. So.
Neither were we.
Okay.
But they said that it wasn't for us to be there. So.
Oh, okay.
It was unnecessary because they were really looking at summers for specific policies. And because of that, we're really necessary to be there.
Well, thank you all for going, because I didn't quite understand what it was for, because it was just posted, I think, and then I didn't think to check further, and I apologize for that.
So I don't know if it was discussed, maybe it didn't need to say Rollinsford, or if it was just going to be saying, should perhaps, maybe Summersworth, I'm not certain.
Yeah, I think there's been a little confusion with that, because it's not a joint board committee. It's two individual committees meeting at the same time, talking about the same thing. And I believe the last meeting they had some specific policies that Summersworth was working on. So I'll talk to Lori and make sure that if they're specific to Rollinsford or specific to Summersworth, that we post it that way.
Yeah, that would be helpful, and it is more formal this year than it has been in the past. It's been relatively informal in the past, so this is a bit more formal. So, and the fact that I haven't been there to understand what was going on is part of the problem, so it falls on me. I apologize for that. So our next school board meeting is November 8th. On November 12th, we have the SAB board meeting, and I think that'll be a preliminary budget meeting, right?
Yes.
For their, and will we see the budget before the meeting?
I'm not sure.
Okay. I think we usually do, but isn't it? Checking. Okay, and then our next meeting is the 14th. Any other items to add to the calendar? All right. School events, I know that Rich did a good job laying out in his report, so I think we're all set there. Unless anyone wants to add any school events. Closing comments by visitors. Closing comments from the board. All right, we are all set. We do have a non-public, so we will take a roll call to take a motion to move to go into non-public, please.
Judy Nelson.
Yes.
Tom Kuhn. Yes. Emily Leach.
Yes.